noticed, but I think, you know, with our great love for the Blessed Virgin Mary, you should be ready at any time to speak about
Amen.
Her.
Very right.
Oh, I am not very sure. I'm sure a lot must have been covered up, but I'm just going ahead, you know, listening to truth again and again is also not bad, probably from a different angle. So I hope, you know, it will be all right. So just show me a when I am close to it, okay?
Okay.
So let's make a short prayer so that we would be greatly enlightened and also fall in greater love with this awesome woman that the world loves and we greatly love.
Hallelujah.
So what is the best way is to ask her to reveal herself through her favorite, our favorite prayer to her. Let us all say the Hail Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now at the hour of our death.
Amen.
Amen. So I'm going to give you a quick 12 unique things about Mary.
Sure, lovely.
All right. So the first one is Mary in God's blueprint. So you see, God has a blueprint for everything he creates, from an atom to the galaxies, for the animate and the inanimate beings. He has a plan, a master plan from which he brings forth creation. And he also has, and in his mind also, there are two pictures, you see. Now he has one blueprint for everybody. But he has two pictures for man. For everyone else, he has just one picture. Whatever his blueprint, that's how the inanimate world, the animals and all of them, except man, is fully fulfills. And it is, and it behaves and it completes God's plan according to the master plan. But not so with God has two pictures for us. One is what we are and what we choose to be. And the other one is what we ought to be according to that original plan. So how do we know? What I'm saying, I'm basing everything today on the scriptures. We are told that there is bookkeeping in the heavens. In many places, it speaks about books. Quite a large numbers. And I think even as we study about how Mary relates to this particular passages I'm giving, to this truth I'm going to present, it will benefit us as well to follow her path. So we know that these books are mentioned, and the more place where it is written in full magnitude is in the book of Revelation, where we know that the Pronto Krator, the Almighty and All-Powerful, the Lord Jesus Christ, who's now seated on the throne, and we are told that he has a book in his hand that no one can open except himself. So that is the destiny and the blueprint for all of creation, including man. And for all of us, there is a plan that God has, his original master plan. Even for himself, scripture talks about in Psalm 47, here I am, it is written about me in the book. So even about the Lord, when he came here, the Father had a particular plan written in a book. So let's make it very clear that all of us don't live the way, you know, we want and the finito. God has this original plan for all of us. We are predestined already what we ought to be. Isaiah 46:16 says, I declaring to the end from the beginning. So all this proves to us that God has a master plan, and which also was for the Blessed Virgin Mary. He tells us, before I have formed you in the womb, I knew you. You see, Again, Moses at that beginning speaks about some books and he says, please, he intercedes, of course, and says, blot out my book if you don't answer my prayer. So it also tells us that bookkeeping is going to be very important when we close our eyes and we will stand before the Lord and books will be open. So God's original master plan that is in Jesus' hand, the destiny of the nations, the destiny of individuals. And then there will be another book that will also be opened. That is how we actually lived, the original plan versus how we match with that original plan. And where do we read it? We see it in Revelations 20:12. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what he has done. So you see, now with all of us, God already knows that we don't match with that book. So we know when the other book is opened, there's going to be a big gap. You see, except two people. One is, and he tells us that, you know, that my name is written. I have come to do your will. He says that in, here I am, it is written about me in the book. I delight to do your will. So there was one who totally and perfectly matched the original plan. But there's another. And that's the Blessed Virgin Mary. Hallelujah. Isn't it awesome? The only one. The only one. So there is only one book, both matching, a whole life. That's how we can understand this mystery, you see.
Yes.
The second thing we'll look at is, what is Mary's role in salvation history?
Yeah.
It's a plan from the beginning of human history. You see, she enters into the picture right at the beginning. In the garden, she's mentioned. Like, in a mysterious way, mentioned. After the fall, the first person God remembers is a son. He's his son, of course. But someone absolutely related to her and necessary for that plan to be fulfilled for salvation is in Genesis 3:15. I will establish enmity between your offspring and hers. He's speaking to the devil, of course. She is to crush your head, but you shall lie in wait for her heels. So there is this woman, this mysterious woman. So why was that? How does Mary enter in? God doesn't do anything by happenstance, you see. Now man has fallen. He's destined now to die, to be separated from God for all eternity. But you know, he won't let the enemy steal precious creation, whom he loved more than the angels. So he says, oh, so it is through a woman who sinned first, remember Eve, that mankind lost his inheritance, his soul. So God always takes vengeance. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. So he says, I will get back what I need. I'll take vengeance by another woman, the new Eve.
Amen.
Amen. It would be through another woman that he would do it. And you know who I'm talking about. I'm sure you know where I'm going.
Yes, yes.
So now you see, these are all mysteries, you see. So let me use an illustration before I go to that. Now, God actually had other options. He could have simply forgiven sin. That would be mercy without justice. Doesn't work.
Yes.
God had to settle this with mercy and justice. And he does it in a very mysterious and unique way. Let me take you to an illustration. The illustration of symphonies, how they are performed. So how does it begin? First, the maestro, the composer, he writes the score. He's got it all there. He puts it on paper. writes the score, then he passes it on to a conductor to be performed exactly like he composed it. But it is quite possible that one of the musicians of all the various instruments, there are large numbers normally for symphonies, he might just choose to rebel and decide to play his own note. You see, so that one note has spoiled the whole perfect symphony. Now again, the director has two choices, you see. He can ignore it and continue with the symphony, or he could stop it and start again. But whatever might be the two things he does, there is one wrong note that wafts into time and space that can never be taken back. It goes into history as an imperfect symphony. You see? So, let us look now at God's master plan in this symphony of creation. But what if this conductor had the power to go back into time and space and seize that wrong note, arrest it, and take that disorder and begin, take that note and begin a new symphony from that one in perfect harmony? Awesome, isn't it?
Awesome.
So we go to the fourth note I want to bring to you. God's salvific plan is exactly that. God could have punished man and created another Adam from dust again, but not so. He would take another Eve, but he decided to take another Eve and bring forth the new Adam through her.
Praise God. See?
But there is one condition, you see, just like when the conductor performs, he can't take away the will of the musicians out there. Somebody can just decide, I won't respond, I'll just play my fancy note. You see? So, Mary had the choice, you see. God did not force it upon her. She was not like a puppet that she had to do it. Because you see, God has given us a free will. He will never touch it. In fact, that's the only thing we really own. And he wouldn't take it even from this master plan he had. And you know, he had to go and take a permission. And we know that. She had to take that consent. And the second Adam, the last Adam, would come through her. But there was these two options. But we know the story, thank God. The fifth thing we know, you see, that she was willing. She was that first note the Lord took and began the new symphony of salvation. Can we give him a big clap to that? Can we honor this?
Yes.
Can you imagine if she had played a wrong note, what would happen? We don't know. It's unknown to man, the catastrophic effects of that one note continuing in time and space.
Amen.
So let's go to the sixth point. Mary was chosen and then she was the blessed one. She had blessings like no other person had. No other great men and women of the Old Testament, and there are quite a few honored. We also have great saints. But you see, no one comes close to the blessings that God gave the Blessed Virgin Mary.
Hallelujah.
So let's look at a few of these. Huh? The first one is the angel blesses her. Someone has to come from heaven all the way, sent, and says,
Amen.
Hail Mary of grace. Luke 1:28. You see, even heaven knew that she was not ordinary. Now, you know, the angel Gabriel was not the only one. All of the angels in heaven, the millions and trillions, knew about it. But one came to tell her that. Then there is, of course, another ordinary woman. her cousin, Elizabeth. She tells her, Luke 1:39-45, blessed are you amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Now we see another dimension here. She doesn't just receive a blessing, but she gives a blessing, you see. There's dual pluses. Some people only take blessings and enjoy it for themselves. But here Elizabeth has another revelation, declares it. You are blessed amongst all women. That's the reception. And blessed is the fruit of your womb. That's the blessing she's going to give us, the Lord Jesus. So, you know, it's good to model her. Don't just keep the blessings for yourself. Keep giving it like the upper room continues to do that. And the third thing is, in a very strange way, this is probably the only prophecy that's given by the person for herself. Now, that's very strange. She herself, inspired by the Holy Spirit, because all scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit. She didn't making up, oh, look at me, you know, I'm the great mother of God. No. She says that all generations from now on, from that moment, will call me blessed. It's a prophetic utterance.
Yes.
You see? She herself sees it. And it's so important that she has to declare it. Because God, she has to obey God, you know. It's never been done with anyone else. But then you have Jesus also who blesses her. Where do you see that? And now, you know, some people use this passage to come to the opposite meaning. It's when, you know, Jesus was very busy with his evangelistic work and people were, and you know, it's already 4 o'clock in the evening, lunchtime is over. And, you know, there's a group of his relatives and the mother, of course, a mother is a mother, you know, she wants to feed her son. And they're waiting out of love. And also, you know, some of them, his cousin says something. So he says, Jesus at that time had very important priorities, just like when he was 12 years old, we had seen it all, his mother and father.
Yes.
But he says very clearly, whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother, sister, and mother. So you see, some Christians misinterpret it. They say, oh, look at Jesus chiding the mother. Uh-huh. The text doesn't reveal that, you see. Yeah. What the text says, he's actually honoring her. He's honoring her and saying, because God actually chose her as the mother. And what are the qualifications? That they must do the will of God. Oh, so all the Christians out there, you know, please, this is the right interpretation. Everybody listening.
Correct. Amen.
Yeah. And then, of course, the big one, we honor her. This evening, we are honor her. There's a whole month dedicated to honor her. You see? For the people who are honored. One of them was Hitler. They said, Hail Hitler. It didn't last too long, but Hail Mary will last forever. Never end. All the Hail Hitlers and Hail Trump and Hail Modi and all the sheikhs. Yes, they're honored because God tells us to honor them. But it's not forever. Right? Then, the seventh thing that I want to highlight about the Blessed Virgin Mary is that she is the greatest praise and worship leader ever. And she begins with that great Magnificat, which beats all the other Psalms. When blessed, she is like a mirror that reflects the blessing and glory back to God. So when she's told, she could say, oh, I'm great. No. What is the first word? Soul magnifies the Lord. That's how we're supposed to do it. When we are blessed and honored for our gifts, for leading good things for the Lord, when somebody honors us, just pass it on to where it should go. When you give a nice talk and you know, do all the good things, you feel so elated. But don't ever take the glory of God on your shoulders until the next day. Get it off your shoulders lift up your hands and say, Lord, that's where it should go. We Amen. May wait until the evening and enjoy some of the nice elation, but not so with Mary. As soon as she's honored by Elizabeth, she instantly gives it back to where it belongs. My soul magnifies the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Now some other few historic things about this woman. Unique woman. She's the only woman who gave a birth to her son who existed before she was born. have you ever noticed that?
Yeah, very true.
The only woman who gave birth to a son who existed before she was born.
Terrific.
Right?
Terrific.
Then you got the ninth one. She was the only mother who was chosen by her son and selected before he was born. Isn't it awesome?
Yes.
And now the 10th one. How awesome. You see, all women bear a frail little child in the womb. I don't know the heaviest child would have been, what size. But here's a womb that held someone whom the galaxies and the universe cannot hold. In this small womb, she was able to hold someone that even Solomon's temple was too small, or even St. Peter's Basilica in Rome is too small. Because Chronicle tells us, Second Chronicles, but who is able to build a house for him, since the heavens, even the highest heavens, cannot contain it? No wonder she's called as the Ark of the Covenant. You see, people sometimes, some Christians wonder, how come we are giving her all this name? But it's the truth, you see. There was a wooden ark, but here is a living ark. And we wonder why we say, you know, she had to be sinless. And there is biblical reason behind it. You look at the temple, the dwelling place of the Lord. Everything is stained by sin, by the way, by Adam's sin. You see, everything is stained. The earth beneath his feet. And that's what's happened to all of creation. That is why you need a new creation, a new heavens and a new earth. Because even the heavens are stained, by the way, because the fallen angels committed their sin there. So God will not allow anything that is even a small stain of sin to continue for all eternity. So what does it tell us? God can never be united with anything that is holy, unholy. So you look at every object in the temple had to be consecrated and cleaned by the blood, right?
Amen.
So if Mary was to hold the living God, had to be kept holy. But that holiness is not something that she generated for herself. It was given in advance, because God is outside of time and space. So it was given to her, and she responded well. Adam and Eve also were given grace, but out of their free will, they chose. I can't hear you, Vijay.
Okay.
Are you getting something?
No, it's okay. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm almost finished. Yes.
No hurry. Take your time. I was just telling my son about something. Yeah.
I thought you were showing me.
Please go ahead.
So you see, it's amazing. One frail woman. Yeah. A young woman in those days, maybe 16, 17, they say, holding someone that cannot be contained in the galaxies and the universe. Today they say there might be a multiverse so vast, and God would just not be able to be contained therein. And it tells us even the highest heavens. So that's an awesome woman there.
Yes.
You see, I was just checking up again. Another one, the 11th one, is that I was checking through the, I just checked it up on the internet, who bore the largest number of children on the face of this earth, recorded at least. So I went to the Guinness Book of World Records and I found that they mention a Fyodor Vasilyev from Russia. And between 1707 and 1782, she bore 69 children because she had quadruplets, twins. So that's over a 73-year span. So which means, you know, she must have lived up to 90 or whatever something.
Yeah.
So, but you know, that's nothing compared to another woman. We can't even count the number of children she has.
Right.
You know whom I'm talking about, right?
No, go ahead. I didn't catch you.
It's the Blessed Virgin Mary has more children than any other woman on earth.
Very true. So many. The whole world is engulfed. Yeah.
And the first son that was formally passed on to her was John, right? And in John, we are supposed to be disciples. So we are all her children. Yeah.
Correct.
More children yet to be born.
Yeah.
So the woman with the largest number of children is not Fyodor Vasilyev's wife, but this great woman.
Praise God. Wonderful.
And I hope all of us will come under her shadow.
Very true.
We will miss a lot.
Yes.
Miss a lot.
Amen.
So,
amen.
Without this great gift that God has given us.
And
finally, the 12th thing is, she's the most loved woman on the face of this earth.
Right. Definitely.
So mostly the celibates, but the young men look for a beautiful woman, right?
Yes.
But you see, there is a whole group of celibates who kneel every morning or through the day at different times to hold the hand of a woman, kiss it and tell her, you love me. These are all these great celibates, the single men who gave the priests who gave their life for the Lord.
Yes.
These are men who are constantly awed by this most beautiful woman, Mother of God.
Amen.
So shouldn't we kneel as well? Shouldn't we hold her hand every day and kiss it and say, you are the woman I love the most?
Of course.
Not the Aishwarya Rai's and, you know, the Marilyn Monroe's, but the most beautiful is this woman. So I hope all of us will love her and honor her. So you see, I could have gone also with other scriptural foundations.
You know.
Most of the most Christians, out of their good desire, Lord Jesus, but they don't realize by honoring the mother, I'm not saying worshiping. The church never tells us to worship. In fact, the decree on Mary in the Vatican II documents is very clear that worship is only offered to God, not to the creature. You see? But we honor her. In fact, we honor Esther, we honor Ruth, we honor Paul, we honor the other Christians, honor many others, you know, the great amazing evangelists in all the various denominations. But we honor with the same sentiments.
Yes.
That's what we do. Sometimes people misunderstand what we Catholics do. Let me tell those brothers and sisters watching, we never do that. Please don't accuse us of something that we never do. But we do honor as the greatest.
Of course.
Esther and Ruth and all the great women of God. Of course. So it's okay to honor our mother. Continue to do that. In fact, the true devotion to Mary, what is the litmus test? Because there are also certain devotions the church says, hey, watch out.
Right.
So, if you have true devotion to Mary, it must take you very close to Jesus.
Amen.
That is the test. Because we also sometimes relate to Jesus himself in a wrong way, to make him like a heavenly Santa Claus, just go to him for things and forget him. In the same way, we can also go to the Blessed Virgin Mary, make nine Navinas, get all your big houses and a husband or a wife, you know, and then that is it. The right devotion is, she's always, saints are placed before us, as Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. Right. If we see the most perfect disciple, the first disciple is the Blessed Virgin Mary. And in all the disciples, even the best, you will find flaws. And we have, there are many, many places where almost all the great men and women mentioned in the scriptures, none of them were perfect. But you don't have a single statement made about this disciple. Because God's original picture, just one for Mary. She fulfilled everything according to the perfect blueprint.
Perfect, yes.
So let's reflect on this and do not be, you know, feeling guilty or condemned when you do that. Because of course, we want to make sure we don't break the first commandment. That's normally, some Christians are worried, unfortunately, you know, they don't know how solid foundation the Catholic teachings are. Because it also came into the picture from a Christological connection. So it had to, her coming into the picture, and God allowed it to emerge, her role, not for herself, but because of her son. And we continue to understand more of that. So Jesus separated from, Mary separated from Jesus is no Mary at all. It's always together.
Amen. Sure.
So I hope this short sharing will allow us to have greater veneration. Veneration is, by the way, a different word from worship. It's the highest form. It's the highest
honor. Honor. Yes. Let's have some question answer, okay? See, if you go to the Google, there is a place where you're reading about Mother Mary, and where is she mentioned? She's mentioned even in the Quran, is that right?
Yeah, you see, she is mentioned, of course. But you know, you see, there are many things mentioned in different shades and little bits.
Yeah.
But you know, when we go for the authentic, it has to be the scriptures. Right, there's lots of things mentioned based on what is already mentioned in the scriptures, you know. But they are not the fullness. If you want to know, if you want to study who the Blessed Virgin Mary is through the eyes of God, the only place, of course, but it is true that she has been mentioned, and I think the Islamic world has an odd lot of honor for Miriam. Yeah. For Miriam. Yes.
But you know what they say? She was the only person who could enter the Holy of Holies. This is somewhere I saw in the Google. I don't know. Trying to clarify.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we should be very happy because, you know, this is like a special honor to women, no?
I know.
So in that sense, you know, which means even the prophecy has been completed, even with the largest population next to Christians, is another group of people who honor her.
Correct. Yeah. That's right.
You know, also in my own experience, I have met people who have come to Jesus, but they began with some kind of a devotion to her, some of them. And Mary never just draws people just to herself.
Yeah, correct.
Who, as he says, is always the greatest evangelist one has ever seen.
Amen.
She's always bringing, and whenever she comes in different apparitions, she has always been concerned about not why to honor me. She never said that, you know. She speaks about, you know, on coming to the Lord and not lose your salvation. And she's very concerned that men and women are forgetting the Savior. So she is very, very concerned about his mission. Now, one question that people ask, why would God send Mary? That's a mystery. God just chose, and that's a fact. He just chooses, just like, why did he send Elijah and Moses on the mountain, you know? Well, God just is sovereign. He just decides to do that.
I know.
So in similar lines, God in his own mysterious way sends these messengers. God could have, God honored Elijah and Moses in such a way that the Father said, okay, these two men, I will use them. Let the world know that, you know, how I honor my saints even in heaven. I send them, not only the angels, I also send.
Correct.
In that sense, what's wrong? There's nothing wrong in God sending the Blessed Virgin Mary to, you know, even speak to us. What does she always speak? How do you know the authentic apparitions from the so-called apparitions? It's always how much of Jesus, how much do people come to Jesus?
Yeah.
And not just the ones who see these visions. That is really the litmus test.
Correct.
Yeah.
Anybody else has questions? Anybody else has questions? Please raise your hand. Well, I think everything is good. No problem.
They say when there are questions, you know, everything is wrong or everything is right.
Brother Savio, unmute yourself to say the closing prayer. Brother Savio, are you there? Brother Anthony, please unmute yourself. Have you unmuted yourself?
Yes.
Sir. Okay. Brother Anthony, first, we have got two people who have come today from Kuwait, isn't it? Two brothers.
Yeah.
Just introduce them, please.
Brother Philip and Ronald.